This is Style, and I'm Elsa Klensch, reporting on some of the most important trends in the year that was 1991. I'll also show you some of the trends for 1992. And we start with a story that's been hot since the spring fashion shows in October.
And what are you doing with all the money?
Saving and investing.
People these days, they talk about it all the time. God, it's a scandal how much money you girls make these days.
At the top of your profession, in any profession, you have to be sort of intelligent to get there.
Since Susie Parker made headlines in the 50s, there have been star models. Jean Shrimpton and Twiggy in the 60s, Lauren Hutton in the 70s, and E-Man and Jerry Hall in the 80s. Now in the 90s, fashion has ushered in the superstars, the glamorous high-profile models who can demand as much as $10,000 a show. As they sometimes do five shows a day, their weekly salaries can quickly climb to six figures. Today's 10 girls at the top are Linda Evangelista, Yasmin Gori, Naomi Campbell, Claudia Schiffer, Karen Mulder, Lena Christensen, Nadege Dubois-Fertus, Tatiana Patez, Christy Turlington, and Cindy Crawford. The question the fashion industry is asking, are the models worth the money they get, especially in these times of recession, or does their high profile detract from the very clothes they're supposed to be selling? The models say they're worth every cent they get and that their job is far from glamorous.
We're working most of the time and you have to go to bed very early, don't go out, don't drink too much and all this.
The way we live is not very glamorous at all. Always working very hard and traveling a lot, being by ourselves all the time, very busy schedules.
Photographer Dan Lecker says the superstars have a walk, a way of turning, a smile of presence that makes his job a lot easier.
Just like a very good photographer or a very good cameraman, if he makes the job well, I mean if he does it well, then he's worth the money. And they do a very good job.
Designers are divided about whether the models are worth the money. Karl Lagerfeld, who does Fendi and Chanel as well as his own collection, is happy to pay up.
You know, the fees are high, but you get it back in a minute, huh? Because the photographers photograph only those. The runway photos make editorial all around the world more than ever before. It doesn't look like showroom stuff and things like this. And, you know, I think they deserve the fee because it will not last forever. This is not a job where they can be for 20 years.
We're about clothes. I mean, I'm designing clothes. And the model, I use a model to express the attitude of the clothes. And the model is not the point. Then designers are paying a lot of money for nothing because the idea is to focus on the clothes.
The jury is still out. If the superstars sell the clothes, they'll continue to get the high fees and perhaps even higher. For there's no doubt they give the shows glamour and excitement. And that thrills the audience, including retailers like Saks Fifth Avenue's Helen O'Hagan. O'Hagan says some big designers like Giorgio Armani don't need superstar models.
Then there are other collections where the star models are really very important. Because, as we all know, they really photograph beautifully. Then those pictures are picked up all across the country. And a designer who maybe didn't have his strongest collection, he'll get a lot of press because of those girls.
And that will sell the clothes?
It will certainly sell the clothes.
Up next, long lengths or short? Designers say either way is okay. They're options for women who want variety. Stay with us. 1991, designers went to great lengths to offer options for the short skirt. While most say short is here to stay, longer hem lengths are the big change, especially for the hot weather. Legs are still important, whether the hem falls just below the knee, around mid-calf, or down to the ankle. Designers show legs through transparent fabrics, button fronts, side slips, and fringe. In New York, Donna Karen has been showing both long and short for several seasons.
I love long in the summertime. I love it bare-legged. I am not an advocate necessarily of spring for long. But I do love it once the weather does get hot and baring your leg and having the option of a long skirt. For fall, I adored long. I should go long and short for fall as well. And I do think that kind of option is important. It gives a woman a sense of movement, you know, and it is for a special type of woman. I find it young and I find it terribly sophisticated.
Marc Jacobs did a variety of skirt lengths for Perry Ellis. He says a woman must consider what she'll wear with the skirt before deciding on its length. especially if she chooses a jacket.
I personally think a short skirt looks better with a jacket, you know, with a blazer, than a long skirt. So when we do long skirts, we mostly do them as shirt dresses, things that unbutton and can be made to reveal the body. Or we do them as long chiffon skirts that are transparent and are worn over bodysuits and things that still allow the body to come through.
In Paris, Karl Lagerfeld says he's fascinated by the contradiction in his new longer silhouettes.
The funny thing is that this longer proportion, but you see more legs than ever in a way, appeals a lot even to the very young girls, even models to the youngest ones. They like it best. A beautiful pair of legs seen through a chiffon skirt is more fun than just displaying the legs.
Sonia Riccio tells me she did long skirts in many fabrics, crepe, organza and jersey. But Riccio also likes to see lots of leg.
I think now we need long skirt, and also for the springtime it's very important to have long skirt, and my long skirt are open just in front of, then you can see the legs like that. It's very amusing also, and under the long skirt, when it's open, you have a Bermuda.
In Milan, Mariuccia Mandelli likes the same look in her Crizia collection.
I showed longer skirts with slits. Some open up the front with buttons and have little shorts underneath. Always a very nude and easy look.
Rosita Missoni teamed long skirts with her oversized sweaters. She puts them in Missoni's trademark patterns and rich colors, and says the shapes were inspired by the longer tennis skirts from the 20s.
The hem of the dresses is mainly important. It's flared and soft. There is a fluidity through the whole collection.
That's a look at skirt length options for 1991. Now the sexiest swimsuits and the most becoming cover-ups of the year. Whether skin-revealing or concealing, bathing suits have never been so innovative in their patterns, cuts, and vivid colors as they've been in 1991. Over them, designers put cover-ups in everything from terry cloth to floating transparent fabrics. New York's Bill Blass continues the year's popular plaid theme in his one- and two-piece suits. He also puts rainbow-bright blocks of color on white for graphic appeal. His suits are fresh, fun, and filled with sex appeal. Milan's Donatella Girombelli creates a sultry look in basic black for the Jenny collection, while Paris designer Terry Mugler wraps bands of black velvet around the body for an unexpected twist. And Christian Lacroix says he likes swimsuits that look like lingerie.
We have a lot of swimsuits, printed swimsuits in stripe, dots, and with a lot of lace. The lingerie look from the haute couture, I brought it into the swimwear. It's like evening wear or lingerie wear, but they are swimsuits and you are able to swim with.
In Milan, Giorgio Armani takes a classic approach in his Emporio collection.
Sono costumi da bagno discreti.
They're discreet. They're not meant to make a man's head spin at the beach, but I think they do create an interest. I've put them in exotic prints in cotton and lycra. I have an antique pink suit with white polka dots and some sophisticated sort of maroon colors with beige backgrounds. And there's a whole series of yellowish gold bathing suits. My bathing suits are seductive, but they're not meant to shock.
Gianni Versace echoes that idea.
They are very one piece, a lot of romantic too. And always I like to cover up with a jeans blouson or a leather blouson or a print shirt.
Biblos designers Keith Varty and Alan Cleaver have two inspirations for their swimwear.
One lot is the graphic black and white ones with the stars, spots and stripes, and then the others are kind of ethnic.
It's real basic, what they call the Olympic swimming costume. But you know, where the interest is on the print and on the embroidery.
In London, the swimsuit takes on greater significance for designer Betty Jackson. Jackson says she sees it as more than beachwear. For her, a swimsuit is the basis of an easy, everyday outfit.
I prefer that look, and I think that now people don't wear swimsuits to get suntans. They wear swimsuits as an item of clothing. So the shape was very important, and you know, the longer leg and the covered up look, and it's very much an item of clothing that you then slip a jacket on or a coat on and go to the beach.
That's a wrap up of swimsuit looks for this year. Coming up next, a key ingredient to exciting clothes, colour. 1991 was filled with a wide variety, from pastels to vibrance, and prints were particularly important. It's all part of living in the 90s. In 1991, designers took their inspirations for colour from around the world, and they made it more important than it's been in years. They used vibrant brights and vivid pastels for exciting solids, patterns and plaids. Their inspiration came from Venetian glass, tropical ocean seascapes, and the brilliant hues of Technicolor. The colours made their collections upbeat and optimistic, full of wit and whimsy. Paris designer Emmanuel Ungaro has built his career mixing vibrant colors in his signature prints. He says this year they're stronger than ever.
I'm trying to do funny things, amusing, with humor. My prints are full of humor too. You know, we have not to take fashion so seriously. It is a very serious business. We have to work very seriously. But we cannot take ourselves seriously.
1991 marked a milestone for New York designer Oscar de la Renta. He showed his collections in Paris. For spring, his colors came by way of his island home, Santo Domingo. The inspiration is the Caribbean.
Yep, absolutely. You know, it's sort of 500 years that my island was discovered. And I thought it would be nice sort of to do something to celebrate. I love celebrations, and this collection is all about that.
Bob Mackie says his shades span the spectrum of colors. His spring collection paid tribute to eight legendary women of the 20th century, including Hollywood glamour queen Rita Hayworth, Betty Boop, sultry songstress Billie Holiday, and comedian Lucille Ball.
It's really a mixed bag. The collection is not one thing because it's eight different women, and I wanted eight different looks. I think women like color, especially in the summer and spring. It's like you've worn all your dark colors all year. You want to, you know, sort of bust out. Although I still have the group of black dresses, but even they have polka dots with bright colors and things like that.
Isaac Mizrahi also went Hollywood to find a sophisticated color scheme. He takes his inspiration from the films of the 50s with the strong tones of Technicolor.
When you see Technicolor movies of the 50s, what's inspiring is A, the colors themselves. They're very multi-level. It's not just one sort of flat pink. It's pink and then you see taupe in it and you see blue in it. Those colors themselves are very rich. And on top of that, when they're mixed together, when it really makes absolutely no sense, something very historic happens, something very modern happens.
Milan designer Anna Molinari pays tribute to the delicate colors of Venice in her blue marine collection. And she tells me her color palette was especially inspired by one of that city's most famous night spots.
Famoso bar dove le donne, che è famosissimo in Italia e nel mondo.
Harry's Bar is the place in Venice where all the fashionable women go. Everybody goes there to see and be seen. It's the most colorful place. I took my colors from the Murano glass that they have there.
That's a brilliant color story of 1991. Still ahead, the trend towards sexy see-through fabrics. Skin-revealing lingerie looks and transparent fabrics played a major role in fashion over the past year. I'll show you more when we come back. Lingerie looks and transparent fabrics for day and evening were two major fashion trends in 1991. Designers used lace and openwork beading to accentuate clothes that cling to the body. Their shapes reflect the simplicity of a slip or camisole. See-through fabrics took on a new importance as trench coats, shirts, and overskirts. In Paris, Claude Montana paired sheers with solids for a dozen different looks.
I tried to do a long, which is, you know, sexy. You can see the legs through transparency. The slit, it's open, the arms are asymmetric, and it's all close to the body.
In Milan, the lingerie influence was the basis of Dolce & Gabbana's collections. They used soft, multi-layered chiffons and organdies for sweet young dresses. But they did corsets and bra tops, garters and stockings to add a hard edge to their floaty looks. Dolce & Gabbana tell me they design with a certain woman in mind.
Ma sono tutte le donne che hanno dentro di sé qualcosa.
She's a very strong woman, very confident, but she also has a great sense of humor, and her clothes always reflect her personality. But above all, her clothes act as an extension of her beauty.
Gianfranco Ferré does some of the best transparent looks of the year. He used lightweight fabrics to create the illusion of bare back, shoulders, and legs.
We are stretched, those kind of silk tulle mixed with organdies. Those are the newest things. They make a new poetry on the slim, on the figure.
New York designer Jeffrey Bean is a master at illusion. He combines different weights of materials and uses transparent fabrics as body contouring inserts.
Fabrics of illusion, which express and femininity. It's a devious, purposeful means, yes. But the first time I'm using silk tulle, there's a lot of silk chiffon. There's printed net. First time I've used printed net in clothes in years.
Lingerie was also a big inspiration for designer Calvin Klein. He likes featherweight fabrics, silk chemise and georgette, because they work so well for day and night. And Klein also believes that simple slip and camisole shapes translate into glamorous evening dresses.
I think the influence comes in the kinds of fabrics that we're all loving right now. They're almost lingerie fabrics. They're as light and airy and soft as what we think of as lingerie, yes.
That's a revealing look at the trend towards lingerie and transparent fabrics in 1991. That's Style for this week. Please stay tuned for all the news as CNN Weekend continues. Next week, I'll be back with more news of fashion. Until then, thank you for joining me with Style. I'm Elsa Klensch. This is Style, and I'm Elsa Klensch, reporting on the design worlds of fashion, beauty, and decorating. Today, the best of the best in fall fashion and a preview of menswear for spring. We start with an innovative collection from one of Europe's most prolific designers. In his fall collection for Fendi, Karl Lagerfeld masterfully mixes fur with fabric. The Rome-based Fendi family has long been famous for its furs, and this season Lagerfeld carries on the tradition in a rich modern style. He does extravagant furs for evening, and for day, the unexpected. He uses wild patterns and patchwork, and even sends out a group of tie-dyed furs.
It's a very modern approach to fur and material, the way I think it should be for the 90s.
What materials have you used?
I mix them. You know, the thing is not what I use and what I'm not using. The interesting thing is how I use it, how I mix it, and how you put the things together, you know. Huh? The best with the worst.
Tell me about the furs. Have you done them reversible, the way you did them last time?
Different. You will see, it's very different. I mixed this time. I quilted them together with silk. The shapes are quite soft. Very, now it's not contriving, you know. Huh? It's a very soft, fluid shape. They have all a very, as the French say, enveloppant. They are like envelopes, you know, you wrap your body in it, because the sensuous thing about fur is that to have a physical contact, to be wrapped in them, you know. No heavy, large, long coats anymore. Everybody has one like this. Huh? They are shorter, they are easier, they are really like wraps, you know. You get into them like a cover you use, and then you take your cover as a coat. Huh?
So the modern coat is something that you just wrap around you, whether it's cloth or fur.
Exactly. And you travel with it, and you use it as a pillow, you use it as a cover, you will whatever you want. Huh?
Lagerfeld fills the ready-to-wear portion of the collection with an abundance of knits. He also does lots of denim, including slit jeans and overalls that he teams with fur-lined parkas.
Nobody knows where the ready-to-wear starts and the fashion begins, where it ends, and so it's all mixed up. The knit is mixed with the fur is mixed with the ready-to-wear. So, you know, everything is very, like it's in life, you know, huh?
Is there a particular color story?
Yes, there are strange colors, strange blue with dark reds and dark green with dark brown and mixers like this, prunes and so in colors like this. Huh? But then suddenly there's bright red and yellow too, you know. It's very upbeat collection. Hmm? Dress the way you want, mix the way you want, and our part is to propose different ways to mix. Huh?
That's Karl Lagerfeld with his fall collection for Fendi. Up next, international supermodel Rochambeau Williams. You'll meet her next when Style Continues. ...24-year-old Rochambeau Williams sees herself as the embodiment of the woman of the 90s. She knows what she wants and she's prepared to work for it. And she's determined she won't change her look or style for the sake of passing fashion. Her natural beauty and engaging personality are quickly taking her to the top of the modeling profession. One of six children, she was born in Philadelphia and raised in Chicago. Rochambeau credits her parents with giving her a strong sense of self and great determination. But she's not afraid to take risks. After finishing her education, Rochambeau gave up a medical technician's career to move to Paris and pursue modeling.
I went actually for vacation, took a two-week vacation from my job, and I went over and went to see about six different agencies, and from there is I got an agency and started working.
What is it that clicked with you? What do you think it was?
I think it was mostly that at that time fashion was turning over, and when I came in with the cropped natural hair, it was something that they were ready for and something that I was also ready for. But a new look, a new style, a new energy, young, fresh, mature, sensual, all that.
It wasn't long after she started runway modeling that magazines picked up on Rochambeau's look. The famous Sports Illustrated swimsuit edition has used her twice and is planning a third shot. Sports Illustrated magazine editor Julie Campbell said she knew Rochambeau was destined to be a star.
Well, first I was attracted to her because of her naturalness. I like her hairdo, I like the way she stands tall, she stands proud. Rochambeau doesn't put on airs.
Rochambeau says a mostly vegetarian diet, meditation, and lots of sleep help her keep a proper perspective on her high-profile lifestyle. And exercise is also very important.
I work out everywhere. Anything I can do to work out, I do. But the thing I focus on mostly are free weights as well as African dancing. I take a special African aerobics dance class, and it just gyrates and works everything in my body. I love fashion. Fashion to me is life. It's living. Because from this, you can do any and everything that you want to do.
Which do you prefer, runway or print?
Well, I like both, but I can say that I love runway the most because I'm able to be a bit more freer and more myself.
Ironically, it was during a runway show for Japanese designer Issey Miyake that Elle magazine publication director Regis Penyes first saw Rochambeau. He decided she had the right personality for his magazine.
You have to be a beautiful girl first, but behind the face, you have the mind. And when you have a good spirit, you can see it in the picture.
I've always been the type of person who's known what I've wanted in my life, and I've been the type of person who gets it through a lot of hard work and determination.
That's supermodel Rochambeau Williams. For fall, Tokyo designer Kyoko Higa shows her first ready-to-wear collection for her own new company. Sizzles with sexy outfits that show off a woman's body. Higa formerly designed for A Rose is a Rose, where she established herself as one of the most innovative young designers in Japan. The first collection under her own company, it's evident that Higa has her finger on the pulse of the fashion needs of young Japanese women. She tells me hearts inspire her. So she opens her show with a high-energy beat and keeps the heart theme throughout. Higa does colorful patchwork in knits and stretch fabrics. She shows amusing pig prints and creates a space-age Garden of Eden group with metallic hearts and flowers. Higa does dresses, suits, and tops in big red sequins, some of which she pairs with velvet hot pants.
I believe everything comes from the heart, energy, love, whatever. It all starts with the heart, and that's why I began my show with a beating heart.
Patchwork's also an important part of the collection.
Yes, I like working with lots of color and different fabrics. These are my strong areas of expertise. I try to challenge myself by finding new ways to coordinate different colors and different materials with each other.
How many different patterns and colors did you have in the patchwork?
I used about 20 different colors altogether. And I would say I used nearly 15 different fabrics, including my knits.
You used buttons for an unexpected effect. It almost looked like embroidery or crochet.
Believe it or not, that look came about simply because I've collected such a great stock of beautiful buttons over the years. I decided I wanted to do something unusual with them, so I used basic jackets that I cut like men's jackets and just added the buttons, like a collage.
Tell me about the fruit and flower group.
I wanted to make something three-dimensional, and these dresses are like a bouquet of corsages and fruit, and I dyed the materials for the fruit and flowers the same color as the dresses.
The finale was very upbeat.
I always like to design something that's cute and happy. And for the 3.5 years I worked with A Rose is a Rose, I was identified with flowers. So with my collection, I want to express something different. I think pigs are cute. They make people laugh.
You're very happy about this collection.
Oh yes, it was very hard work, but I enjoy the drawing, the styling, the designing, and although this is a smaller show by comparison to A Rose is a Rose, I didn't have to worry about mass producing pieces. I was able to create something really personal, and the reaction has been favorable, so when I get such good reviews, I feel happy.
That's Kyoka Higa with her full collection.
More important because some people like it very skimpy, other people like it.
Luxurious leather and suede coats are the cornerstone of the Mario Valentino 4 collection. From sexy, swinging silhouettes edged in fringe to comfortable quilted shapes, Fortuna Valentino does a variety of lengths and colors. Valentino says she's come up with a new faux black called Violino, but she includes plenty of neutrals and vibrant brights to round out her color palette. Suits are important with short skirts, and Valentino often does the skirts in pleated suede for easy movement. She mixes solid separates with floral patterns for a little pizzazz, but she tells me the news of the season is shape.
La novità nella forma è la forma ad A.
In this collection, we've included lots of A-line shapes in coats, jackets, and skirts. Personally, I love the A-line silhouette. Shoulders are a little more normal, not so padded, and the upper silhouette is straighter with a little more volume on the bottom.
Is leather more important than suede?
I think so. We've used an awful lot of leather because I think it's more exciting and ready to wear. It has a stronger look. We've quilted it to give it more volume, and some of the quilting has a wave motif.
But you do use suede because it moves a little easier than leather.
Suede is easy to wear, but our leather is also soft and supple. We pair leather with suede for some of our suits, and we've used fringe because it adds a feeling of movement.
Have you done any special looks for evening?
Abbiamo un serpente di vernice.
We have a snake pattern that we do in very interesting shades, from dark to bright. And we've made the leather in some of the skirts and suits look cracked or crinkled. Plus, we've included shiny leather this time, kind of a patent leather wet look, but also in the crinkled style. They're not smooth at all, and these come in black for an elegant evening look. The color and texture add a special character or quality that makes them quite unique.
That's Fortuna Valentino with the Mario Valentino 4 collection. Coming up next, New York designer Fernando Sanchez puts his emphasis on colorful, exciting evening wear for fall. His sexy dresses and separates have Sanchez's famous lingerie influence. He does plenty of loungewear for at-home living and puts everything in easy-to-wear fabrics that are as luxurious as they are functional.
The evening was originally an offshoot of the most extreme part of my homeware, which was the most dressy part. So we put it one stage further, right? So the clothes were, by definition, were geared towards parties and evening wear. It's not city wear, it's not street wear, it's strictly evening wear. Stretch, yes, there is a bit of stretch, which is not the main part of the collection, and we use traditional fabrics, which is, you know, lace. We are known now for doing rather good lace clothes, tulle, and the traditional fabrics that are used for the evening wear.
The shapes are close to the body.
Yes, well, you know, because also I think, well, I like rather seductive women, so I try to give them seductive clothes. So I like the shapes, so I follow the shapes of the body.
Lengths were both short and long.
I don't think it is a particular issue on the level of fashion. So I played with uneven hemlines, which solved a lot of problems. But I don't have a particular point of view about length. I think it also depends very much on the women. I think arbitrary judgments on fashion today, I think, are a bit passé. I think women have to decide how they want to function and what they look well in. You know, some girls might look very, very good with very, very short clothes. Other women should have to look at themselves in the mirror.
The at-home wear, did you have a particular point of view?
The wardrobe is, stays at home. So it's a home living, it's a vacation living, it's a beach living, it's a cool living, and it is a pleasure living. You know, I think it has to do with pleasure and with maybe indulgence.
And so the colors must be bright and happy.
So I have tried to put together a wardrobe which can be put together in rather unorthodox ways without, you know, classical considerations of colors. So you can clash the colors and you can wear a top with a turtleneck with different kind of leggings underneath. We have an entire wardrobe of odds and ends, tops and bottoms and camisoles that you can mix and match the same way that you mix and match sportswear, because the principle is on the same level and is parallel to a sportswear point of view.
That's Fernando Sanchez with his fall collection.
That's
Jota in cotton, in chiffon, in brocade, in cotton brocades, a lot of different ways.
And now we've talked about the skirt, let's get down to the shapes.
Shapes is mostly narrow, quite a few ruffles. I love, you know, I have sort of short skirt and long skirt, but I don't feel that the skirt is an issue at all. It's just that, you know, a woman wears whatever she wants. And it's, what is important is the clothes themselves, their vitality, and what they mean in a woman's life, you know.
Is it stronger on day or evening?
The daytime clothes are very, very important. Very simple, but very important. And that is sort of the, you know, because the day starts very, very simple, and because at night, where the fantasy starts, then it's there's much more fantasy.
You love the fantasy?
Yes, of course, everybody loves to fantasize. You know?
Not everybody, Oscar.
Well, you might not, but most people do love to fantasize. You know, I think that it's sort of, it's one indulgence in life that costs nothing, and I think that, you know, it is wonderful to dream and to think of things, you know. Life without it, it means nothing.
I'm very happy about this collection.
Oh, it's very close to my heart, as you can say, absolutely.
That's Oscar de la Renta and his spring collection. Coming up next. And now, revealing outfits with a soft hand from one of Italy's most innovative designers. In one of his best spring collections ever, Milan designer Gianfranco Ferré takes his inspiration from the sky, the sand, and the sea. He does bathing suits with a seashell motif, then puts them in rubberized lycra to make the models look like mermaids in the moonlight. And he uses organza that's as light as a breeze for prints that feature billowy white clouds. Ferré says his collection is filled with fantasy and has a fresh direction where color is concerned.
Everything more simple, more as the girls want to be. It's something new, it's something that makes her personality to come out. And even the shapes are even more and more easy.
You have used many beautiful colors too, like particularly the blue.
Yeah, that's a point of, a new point of view. The air, the sun, the sky, the water. The story is on the sky, on the sand, on the water, inside the water.
Where were you when you got this idea?
Just in Milan, that's a great thing.
Tell me about the prints.
prints just a few. There is something, a new technique of photographic reproduction. We have one print that is like the Matisse sky. Then we have another one, it's the deep underwater ocean, multicolored. And then we have a black and white play, like taken from the Fournazette inspiration, like the big shells story.
All these are photographic prints?
Yeah, photographic prints and computerized reproductions.
And you've used them both for day and evening?
Yeah. But mainly the day, because the evening we use just lots of brocade that repeat the same story.
Gianfranco, I know you love to experiment with fabrics.
Yeah.
What are the new ones this season?
Lurex, stretch, those kind of silk, tulle mixed with organdis. Those are the newest things.
And you like them because they're comfortable and they're so lightweight.
Yeah, and even they make a new poetry on the slim, on the figure.
Tell me about the swimsuit.
Swimsuit, they are, you know, those rubberized and bright stretch lycra. We have something, it's a lycra mixed with shells, small shells.
You've used a lot of sequins and beadings for evening.
Yeah, but it's simple, something like a knitwear that it's a mix with sequins. It's not beaded. It's knit, you know? It's elastic. It's elastic fabric, yeah.
The finale, though, they were very tight little dresses.
Yeah, very, very simple. Yeah. Those are like a t-shirt for the beach. Beaching on the night.
Gianfranco Ferré and his spring collection.